This is a walkthrough through 8-4-C, which is the last shot of the movie, well, before the credits. And it's old Tom hugging the robot. And this is a huge file, and it really was very hard to set up. So I was just doing the camera tracking, and Andy was doing all the compositing. And of course, Jeremy did the animations of all these robots. So it's a gigantic file, and it has a couple of challenges. Well, one of them was that, of course, we didn't have such a big green screen studio. That would have been, well, very large. So we had to do a track extension. So the camera was going, I think, from here to there. And then the rest is just a virtual camera that is then extended. And in that process, there were a couple of messy things, mistakes. For example, his hair is flickering, as you can see here. And I think that is the compositor messing up on several render nodes. I think maybe it's the sharpened filter or something. So there is some glow issue here. So that's why his hair is blinking. The other thing is that the footage is a little bit blurry. That is because during the track extension I was using the HD files and not the 4K to make it a bit faster, and then time went by and we didn't re-render that. And then in the end I tried to re-render with the 4K footage, and then something went wrong and it didn't line up anymore. So, well, this is what we've got. So let me show you the file. So if I open up the track file, you can see here that we did the hugging by Ton, the founder of Blender, holding a green box, the hugging device, and moving it slightly so that our main actor could then touch this box and it would react to the movements. And so this would be simulating the robot's head. And as you can see, the camera doesn't go out that far, as you see in the shot. So this was then extended by a virtual camera. So there was quite a bit of green screen work and masking to get rid of the markers and these sticks and of course that green box and also here. So we had to get rid of that. And the camera track was extremely simple, of course. I mean, there are lots of markers, there's lots of depth, so that's quite a good track. And I assume that the camera is having lens distortion, but I didn't even consider that because the main focus of the shot is in the center and usually there is not that much lens distortion. So instead of having to go all this undistortion distortion way, I was just solving that without caring about lens distortion. So that's why there is zero. Then the other thing is that there is an object track, and at first it looks fairly simple because there is some depth, but it turned out to be not quite as simple. Because at least here in this track file, the object track is inverted. So you see here is this blue marker, but in the file, the blue marker is on the left front corner. Here is it on the right corner. So it's kind of flipped and inverted. For, I really don't understand how that can happen, because if you look through the camera, well, it's correct, but then here it's, everything is kind of messed up. So this is the camera, and then from this perspective, that blue marker is here. But then if I look through that, it's here. So it's inverted. So this track didn't work, and I think we didn't even use that. So instead of investigating further, I will jump right into the extension file, because here there is a better object track. So I assume that during the workflow I was solving that again here in that file and then using that as an extension. So the track file, you cannot use that, it's broken. Okay, so this is the extension file, and first let me have a look at the movie clip editor. So there is the camera solve, and it's even having a better solve error. And then there's the object track, and the object track. And if I look at the tracked camera, which is this one, then if you look at the markers, that looks now much better. So the object solve is in this file. So here it is correct. But then the other thing is that you can see here the setup of the track extension. Now let's first see what the cameras are doing from this perspective. So it's a bit slow, but that's just my computer. So there is the tracked camera over here, and then up there, there is another camera, which is named Target. And this is much further away. So if you look through the through that camera, Control Zero, then this is the extension. So this is how far the camera will go. And the camera that is used for rendering is blending between the tracked camera and that target camera. So this is called BlendCam 84C. And this camera is the, in the shot, it's the active camera that is used for rendering. And by using constraints, it will blend between that camera and that. And this works because this is a linear motion. So if I display the camera path, this is the motion of the actual camera. Maybe I can quickly change that theme because that way you can see the camera better. So somewhere here should be camera path. Camera path. Ah, there we go. Okay, so make that blue. So this is the camera path, and it's a fairly straight motion. So frame one, it starts here, and at the last frame, it's there. And to extend that, I was using this blend cam, and this blend cam is using a couple of constraints. So there are two copy location constraints and two copy rotation constraints, and they are keyframed. Maybe we just have a look at the copy location. So at frame one, the influence of the actual tracked camera is one, but the target camera influence is zero. And then here, this is first using the actual camera. So from frame one up to frame 180 something, the tracked camera will be the main motion. And then the other camera takes over by decreasing that influence. So here, the influence of the tracked camera gets smaller and the target influence gets bigger. So during these frames, slowly the target camera takes over, and that way we can extend that motion. The problem is that if the virtual camera gets further away, then the footage doesn't match anymore. So if I blend in the background images, you can see Tom here. So at first, everything's fine, so it lines up perfectly. But then, I think this might be using the 4K footage now. Let's see. Yeah, maybe I can switch that to HD. Okay, that should be a bit faster now. Anyway, so this is the HD this is much faster. Great. Okay, so here, this is all the actual camera. But then when the other camera takes over, which should be in about 20 frames, so now it doesn't line up anymore. So as the camera gets further away, you can see that the box isn't in his hands anymore. And that's why we had to do something different. And that is by using a plane in the 3D viewport. So on this plane, I don't know if you can see that, maybe in a rendered view. Yeah, so you can see that. So at first, in the first frames here is Tom hugging that box, but it doesn't really line up. And in the first 180 frames in the composite, the actual footage is being used. But then when the camera, when the other camera takes over, we blend from the footage to the extended track, to that. Now, unfortunately, Cycles doesn't really update unless we have that sequence open. But I'm not going to do that now. You just have to trust me. So the frame that you see here is not the actual frame of the sequence. But what's happening is that now, when I go through camera view, this would now use the Blender would now render the frames that it is seeing on that plane. And that plane, because it is in the perspective viewport, it will then line up with the camera and the camera motion. at least the position and rotation should be the correct ones. But because the camera is also moving out, we had to animate the scale so that plane is parented to an empty, and that empty is animated. So you can see the scale is changing from first to last frame to compensate for the movement. So I hope this all makes sense. This is a little bit complicated. And the other reason why that is working is because we have stabilized the footage. So if I go into the 84C directory, you will find the 84C track stabilize. And if you open that, you will see the node editor with stabilize 2D. But maybe first, let's have a look at the movie clip. So this is using the cleaned footages first. So there is the path to linear 84C. And you will see that there is one active marker sitting on the foot of him, and that has been used to stabilize him. Now currently we are in the reconstruction panel of the track, so if you go back to tracking, you will find it looks the same. But in the reconstruction panel, you can go to display and then turn off stable. Still it looks the same, and that's because the stabilization started on this frame. Now that also makes it a bit weird because his foot is cut off, which is, I have to say, it's a little mistake on my side, but because the robot in the end had its foot in front of him, so that was no problem. But if I now go to this frame, 300, you can see he's of course moving because the camera has been moving away and the footage looked like this. But if you have this one marker here and add it to the 2D stabilization by just clicking on this plus sign with that marker selected, it will be stabilized to this marker. Currently you cannot see that, but in the compositor you would actually be able to use the stabilization. Now to be able to preview that, you can enable the stable button, but only if you are in the reconstruction panel. But this is now how the stabilization is working. So it starts here, and then because the marker isn't really tracked at this point, nothing is happening. So here the footage is moving normally. And then when the track is starting, you can see now he is staying at that point. And this white outline is indicating where the footage would be if you wouldn't stabilize that. And that is why if you put this on a plane and put it into the 3D viewport, it will stick on that one point, and that is necessary if you want to have a track extension. So that is one thing, and then of course in the compositor you have to use the stabilize 2D node. So that would be in distort, stabilize 2D, then you have to pick the correct movie clip if you have multiple, in this case it's just this one, and then you just put it in here. And first, this is the normal footage, so to say, and this is now the stabilized footage. So it will be put to this one point. There are different algorithms for sampling. The best quality would be bilinear. Bicubic is also nice, but can be a little bit blurry. So now, this is a while ago, I did this in July, I think, end of July. And when I was doing that, I was first exporting to Linear HD to make everything a bit quicker, because we also had to animate it in the viewport and it wasn't clear if it would work at all, so it was a bit of a mess. So I've exported that to Linear HD, and then when Andy was doing the main composite file, he was also using the Linear HD stabilized footage in the viewport. And in the viewport, that made it a little bit blurry. Now, the thing is that after that, when I wanted to prepare for the DVD, I wanted to re-render that using 4K stabilized footage, but it didn't really work. So one reason was the render times were just too high, and the other thing is that the export to 4K was a bit weird, and I couldn't really find out what was going on. And then, just a while ago, I was looking at the footage again. Maybe let's have a look at the extension file. The thing is that if you look at the stabilized footage in the movie clip editor, then something strange is happening. But in the composite, it would still work. Let me just show you. So I go here, maybe Alt-O to open up a new movie clip instead of replacing the footage. So it starts at frame one, which is a little bit strange actually, because I thought I was cleaning only up to start frame 20, but anyway, that's how it is. So at frame 175, everything looks fine. Then he's moving, and then there's a jump. And it's weird. I don't know what exactly is happening here. Probably has to do with the offset. Actually, this might be the explanation. Haha, that's right. So I think, well, don't care about that. It will work in the render because the extension uses only frame 187. So before it will be the correct footage and then the composite takes over to frame 187. So this footage, the stabilized HD, is used in the 3D viewport. So the texture here is using stabilize HD. Unfortunately, because it's not the best quality. Anyway, that is what we are using. So this is the original cleaned. Then in the composite, this is just a test setup, so to say, so to simulate what's going on. So if I render that, we should be able to see what's going on. And excuse me if this is a bit confusing, but I have to do this sort of last minute, so I couldn't prepare that well and don't make a tutorial, so this is a bit messy, everything. So here, there's just this simple test background. Then we've got the movie clip, and here at this frame, we have 50% influence of that. And here is the tracked and extended footage, which has 100%. So this is now replacing the footage here at frame 187. But just one frame before, the influence of the clip is zero. But the influence of the footage here is 100%. So at this point, this is where we take over. So all the frames up to 186 are using the actual cleaned footage from the movie clip inside of the compositor. And then the next frame, we take over and use the clip. So here, we start to use the clip from the viewport. So everything that is rendered on that plane will be used in the composite starting from frame 187. And now I just figured out how we could fix the 4K problem, so maybe I can actually save something that you can use if you want to re-render with 4K, but never mind. So the file is using the linear, should be using the linear HD here. So let's have a look at the actual file. So this is the file 8.4c, and I mean this is very slow because there's lots of geometry, but if you look at the plane, I hope I can select that now, it's also sitting here in the viewport and it's also using that texture. So it's using the stabilized HD starting from frame 1 and going up to that frame, starting at frame 1. And here in the composite somewhere there should be the animated nodes where the takeover is happening. So this is the alpha over node where we have the original footage, which is weirdly enough clipping. Why is that happening? I have no idea. Then there is the animation of these values. And here in this case, the animation just is not happening from one frame to the next. Here the animation takes a few frames to make the transition a bit smoother. So that would be here. So starting from frame 187, where we have the correct stabilization, the movie clip footage should be zero or at least just 50%. So that is here. So it starts to be less, and maybe it's just one frame later. So, okay, let's see. At this point, Andy was changing the setup a little bit. So here, okay, so here the actual footage, the movie clip, has less influence, and the plate from the viewport has 100% influence. So here we sort of take over. And then, because as I've told you before, I was exporting linear HD, and back then also the scale node was blurring everything, so it was using a different algorithm, so everything was a bit messed up. So the footage was blurry, and that's why Andy was using the sharpen filter to get rid of that, and I think that also introduced some of these issues that you can see here. And that glow, that you can see the blinking glow, that was, I think, the compositor messing up on different render nodes, maybe because of OpenCL or something. But this is the node setup. The other interesting part on this in this file is that we actually had to bake the entire dome. So, I have no idea how Andy was able to render this. This is amazing. Because you know, the dome was a great model, but it was so heavy and cycles couldn't do it, or we couldn't do it. It was just insane. Like, look at all this detail. This is, in fact, I just had to reopen Blender because it was crashing and it wasn't even loading this background element. Oh my god, this is insane. So the group is dome matte projection. And maybe let's just open that, because I think I'm done with that file. So because what he had to do was to bake everything down to a model. So if I go into the model environments dome and then open up the dome matte projection, 270 megabytes. Let's see if my computer can handle this. I think what he did was to merge everything to one material, to one object, and then bake that to a texture. But I don't know how exactly he was doing it. Okay, so I think, yeah, this is the image. So he was rendering that at 4K or 8K from one perspective over one entire night. And then projected this image onto the geometry. And I think the geometry is kind of broken down and baked and merged to one object. Then with a project UV thing, he was projecting the background onto that file. And that's the only way how we could render this, because it was too heavy and too complicated. Yeah, so I think that's basically 8.4c. It was a little bit messy, but yeah, that's it.